New this morning at just half past the hour here on MSNBC Sunday, scientists say the oil spill damage to marshes along the Gulf Coast may require some drastic measures, including some risky solutions involving fire and flooding to either burn the oil or flush it out. Meanwhile, BP says it wants to keep using a controversial dispersant to break up that oil, but the government wants BP to use something less toxic. This morning, I talked with one longtime fishing captain in Venice, Louisiana, about the impact the oil spill is having on business and, for many, a way of life.
The scene in most cases like this marina here, which we built back in 1985, some mornings, instead of 100 boats leaving the dock, one or two are leaving the dock. The captains are sitting around waiting, hoping that they might get a charter, or hoping they might get a chance to go to work for British Petroleum. This is something, they're in limbo. They don't know what they can do. They don't know whether they're going to be fishing tomorrow, sitting at the dock. And what do you tell your financial institution? Well, I think I might have a charter tomorrow. I might be able to make some money next week. These guys are sitting around. They don't know what they're going to do for the rest of their life. The banks and the lending institutions and the mortgage companies are giving them 6 months or so of deferred payments. So, yeah, they are helping. Good thing, because a lot of these young captains, you see, they're running boats that cost $200,000. Some of them have two or three boats. And can you imagine what the notes must be for that?
What are officials saying to you about the likelihood of getting life back to normal, when that might happen?
You're hitting me in the heart there. It's difficult. Once this oil gets up in the marsh, and I relate it to your flower garden at home, would you go walk around in your flower garden? No, you would trample down. The same thing can happen to our marsh. It's a catch-22. Do we let the oil stay up in the marsh, or do we get in there with the airboats? Do we get in there with the skimmers and beat it down ourselves? It's a lose-lose proposition.
And that was part of my earlier conversation with longtime fishing captain Dave Ballet. Government officials estimate that at least 6 million gallons of oil have leaked into the water so far. Meanwhile, that cleanup effort along the Gulf Coast, that is getting some star power. It is called the Kevin Costner Solution, and this week, officials in Louisiana will give it a shot. Actor Kevin Costner has invested 15 years and about $24 million of his own dollars in the project. Joining me live now from San Diego, California, conservation biologist Reese Halter with Cal Lutheran University. Reese is also the author of The Incomparable Honeybee, and a good morning to you, Reese.
Good morning, Alex.
I want to hear about this Kevin Costner solution, what exactly it is and how it's supposed to work.
Okay, well, what we have is basically it's a big vacuum, and it's going to suck the oil out of the water and spin it real quickly around, and you get excellent separation, like 97% of the oil away from the water.
Okay, so and then what? Can the oil be reused? Or at this point, we don't even really care that much. You just want to get it out of the water. But is that, I mean, first of all, has this been tried, proven, tested anywhere? I mean, do we know this thing works?
On land, it works. But in the big picture, in the sea, we're not quite sure. That's what's the first thing we're going to see early, either tomorrow or Tuesday. But, you know, the real problem here, Alex, is we actually don't even know how much oil is pluming from the seabed. The estimates now, and I've been in touch with six eminent scientists across the nation, it's likely 2.5 million gallons a day.
Oh,
so
wow.
It's phenomenal. These machines that Kevin has can take 200 gallons a minute and spin it. So there's 20 available. We're going to need everything we can muster here.
Yeah, well, 20, I mean, and that's great. If these things work, that is awesome. But we're talking about the Gulf of Mexico. I mean, it's a huge space now. Some of this oil's gotten into the jet stream, down the warm water stream. I mean, how many of these might we really need? There's 20, but you'd think you need a lot more.
Thousands. And as you mentioned, this dispersant is toxic, and they're pounding it in, 700,000 gallons of it. And even, you know, Britain said stop it. And well, we're just going into it.
Wow. What about this top kill technique, the one that was supposed to be tried today? Now it's been put back till Tuesday. What are officials and people like yourself thinking in terms of its efficacy? Is it going to work?
It's very delicate, Alex, because unless it's 100% sure, that is, unless when they're blowing these tons of mud at 152 atmospheres of pressure they're working against, unless it's 100% jammed in there and then cemented down, we run the risk of the wellhead blowing, and then it becomes even a bigger epic disaster here.
Yeah. You heard part of the conversation there with the fishing boat captain, Dave Belay, and he's looking at a long time of problem for the fishermen to try to recoup their losses. But environmentally speaking, Reese, how long are we going to feel the effects of this mess?
Oh, Alex, this is decades. This is an ecological disaster of epic proportion, because once the oil and the dispersant land, and they're landing already in the marsh, there's no way really to get it out. It suffocates everything. Burning it, blowing it back into the sea is not going to happen. And look, as everybody said, 8 days from now is the beginning of the hurricane season.
Wow, Reese Halter, pretty sobering discussion. Anyway, thank you for it. Appreciate
awful.
It. Yeah,
yeah,
it is.
Thank you.